Welcome back to Suncoast View. April is National Gardening Month, and it's easy to understand why. With all the flowers and plants blooming around us, it just makes us want to upgrade our gardens. But before you start digging, we have some tips from an expert. We welcome Alex Barth, Landscape Design Manager from Troy's Tropics. Welcome back, Alex.
Hey, thanks. Thanks for having me.
We're always happy when you're here because the set always looks more beautiful.
That's right.
Lovely flowers. So, all right, even if we're having spring fever and we want to kind of upgrade our gardens and yards a little bit, is this a good time of year with the weather changing and the rain and then hot days after?
Yeah, it is. Florida, you know, is variable as far as weather, but, you know, spring and early summer is a great time to plant. We are far enough south where you can technically plant year-round, but this is prime time right now.
Oh, good. All right, so you brought us actually some samples of things that would be good to plant this time of year. So let's start down in front.
Definitely. The first thing we have there is bush daisies. Now, bush daisies are fantastic. They bloom off and on throughout the year. They really provide just a nice yellow color. A lot of people do it this time of year for Easter colors, the bright, the yellow, and they're very resistant to things like insect and disease.
Are those perennials? If we plant
they
them,
are.
They
they're technically classified as perennials. So once they get a little straggly, you just cut them back and they'll continue to grow back and then thrive and bloom again.
Oh, good. Nice.
Yeah. And so the next thing we have down there is pentas. Pentas are fantastic. Hummingbird and butterfly attractants, commonly planted in the spring. They have real soft colors, like you see the soft pink there. Just wonderful asset to other colors like yellows, purples, reds, things like that.
Are either of those plants so far, the bush daisies or the pentas, direct sunlight? Do they like a little shade?
So mainly the bush daisies would be more full sun. Pentas can get away with a little bit of partial sun. So as long as you have about 5-6 hours of sun, both of those will do pretty good.
Okay.
Yeah. So you could put them side by side.
You could definitely put them side by side. And make sure to amend the soil. You know, this time of year, you want to make sure to amend with compost and things like that before you do your main planting for the season. So that's another tip. And then, yeah, we have salvia. Salvia is fantastic. Again, they attract butterflies. They attract little bees, which are important. Bees are, you know, slowly going extinct. Bee colony collapse, things like that. They attract birds, hummingbirds, things of that nature. Just a fantastic asset. They, you know, grow nice and full, and they're wonderful year-round in the landscape.
Now, those get a little bit bigger, correct? So we need to make sure we have some space because crowding can kill things.
Exactly. With salvias, you know, they would be like a second-layer plant. So if I was planting, I would do something like the bush daisies first or pentas and have the salvia behind that. And then you have a nice two-layer concept there that would look really pretty.
Okay.
Oh, nice. Yeah. All right. And then I like that they're functional and hardy and still beautiful. Like they have the, you know, the spring colors that we like.
Exactly. Landscaping should be about aesthetic purposes, you know, really having vibrant colors, and it just always makes a difference. And curb appeal, that's so important. And then next we have the marigolds. These are really cool. They actually make insecticides from the marigolds. It's called pyrethrin. And in the 1950s, they actually used to treat children for lice with pyrethrin.
Really?
So they have naturally occurring insecticidal properties.
So if I put those on my porch, like in pots or around the edge, will it help with bugs?
So that's the theory. Probably not. But it does have, some properties that claim to help. Mainly in like a vegetable garden, you would plant those on the outside perimeter, and it does have some effectiveness.
I've heard that too. So the rabbits don't like them, or the squirrels don't like them as much so that they won't come in and mess with your vegetables?
Exactly. Yep. Exactly. Well, not really animals, but more insects.
Okay.
So, yep.
Okay.
Okay. So next we have the bougainvilleas. Those are fantastic. You can basically plant them year-round. Vibrant colors. I mean, these things are so awesome. Drought tolerant once established. I mean, they just provide colors and colors. They're wonderful.
Oh, isn't that beautiful?
I do love those, and I know that we have a lot of those in our yard, and so I know the name of them.
Yep, there you go.
And those are also full sun, is that correct?
They are full sun. They love full sun. Don't put them in too much shade.
So you brought us some great examples of things that would thrive now, but we also kind of want to make sure that we are doing, when we upgrade our gardens and our yards, we're doing it properly and responsibly.
Yeah.
So we've talked before you came to tell us. We all know last year was a bad year with red tide and then kind of the green algae in the waterways. Is there something we can do now in our own yards to be a little more environmentally conscious?
Yes. Last year was so bad with red tide. It was, you know, it was on the news everywhere. So a couple key points, okay? Use a time-release, slow-release fertilizer. That way you're not using stuff like Miracle-Gro, which leaches into the soil instantly. So you're pushing nitrogen, phosphorus, all those things that are responsible for exaggerating red tide and exaggerating slime and green algae in the fresh waterways.
So we should ask for time-release fertilizer.
Yeah,
when we
slow-release or time-release fertilizer.
Okay.
It's so important. Also, have your irrigation checked. We're in Florida. It rains a lot. There's no need for your irrigation to run a lot. So you just want to make sure that an irrigation tech or someone comes out, or you can look at your timer yourself. Make sure it's only running a few times a week and not every day. It's just not necessary.
Because part of the problem is when too much of our fertilizer water ends up
exactly
downstream.
And most, believe it or not, most of our sod and our grasses don't need constant spraying from, you know, liquid fertilizer and things like that, especially if we're on the waterways. That stuff leaches in, and it really exaggerates the problem.
Wow. It's, I mean, it is important to note there are things we can do in our own yard that do make an impact.
Most definitely. Yeah, you want to believe the small things that we do add up to big differences mm-hmm. if a lot of people are doing them. So, yeah, don't discount yourself individually.
This is also the time of year where, you know, Easter's coming up, and a
yes.
lot of times we will bring flowers or plants to someone as a
yes.
gift. You have some important tips for choosing flowers.
Yeah, so first off, I have a funny story. Okay, Easter lilies are usually given. They're fantastic, but I went to a traditional Easter Sunday at a Catholic church, and there was this woman. I thought she was, like, you know, needing an exorcism. Well, it turns out she was highly allergic to all of the Easter lilies at
the
front.
Oh, my gosh.
And a lot of people are. So she had a violent allergic reaction in church. So be careful when you're picking out things like hyacinth, Easter lilies. People are allergic to these
oh.
things.
That's important to know.
Linda will tell you about that. Linda's allergic
yeah.
to
a lot of things.
Are orchids generally safe for most people?
Orchids are generally safe. They don't contain a lot of pollen, so that's a safe one. And the cool thing is we're trending toward having live plants instead of cut flowers.
Right.
Live plants, they last. So
right.
you give it as a gift to someone.
It's a great gift.
Great
yes.
tips.
Good
Thank
idea.
You, Alex.
Great
for more
you.
Information about gardening this time of year and all floral questions, you can go to troystropics.com. Coming up next, we're going to learn how a photographer captured a different side of the sun coat.